So a very good afternoon to all of you. Can you all hear me? Say right yes if you can, or speak. Raise your hands if you can. Can you all hear me? Okay, fine. So today we are beginning the first in the postgraduate research series lectures. And I have taken a topic which will be of relevance to all of you. The topic is how to write a good synopsis for your MD, MS, DM, MCH thesis. I thought who would be better to discuss this with you than those who have had first-hand experience. There are three postgraduates of my department. They have worked and they have prepared this under my guidance. So I will be sitting here all the time as they present, and if there are any questions, then they will be addressed to me. And if you have any doubts, then you can come and meet me. My name is Dr. Shelly Awasthi, and I am heading the Department of Pediatrics. After the postgraduates finish their talk on how to write a thesis, an equally important topic, that is how to integrate research and residency. A brief on that will be given by Dr. Nisha Mani Tripathi. She's a faculty in the Department of Geriatric Mental Health. In the chat box, you will see a Google form link has been pasted. So when everything finishes, please fill the Google form and submit it. Only those whose Google forms are submitted will get an e-certificate of participation in today's activity. So I wish you all a very nice learning, a very pleasant experience, and I look forward to your positive or comments for improvement at the end of the talk. And let me introduce the three speakers. The three speakers are Dr. Anshika, Dr. Garvita, and Dr. Devina. So we begin with them and Madam Kage. And Madam is here. She is Dr. Nisha Mani Pandey. So without any further delay, we start. The whole session will take approximately 1 hour and 30 minutes. And I request you all to stay throughout. I'm sure you will have a great learning. Please start.
59 or 11. 11.
57.
18. सौ लोग सुपर नहीं बैठ रही
है
कुछ नहीं
इसकी कितनी
कैपेसिटी है
सौ गुड डे तक क्या कर
लोगे सौ से ज्यादा हो जाएंगे मैम
क्या करोगे
दूसरा नहीं लगा दूंगा मैम पहुंचाएंगे तुरंत हम दे देंगे
तो कुछ भी चेक करके आएंगे ठीक
करिए इसको हां
ये नहीं बीच में एक अनाउंसमेंट कर दी दूसरा लिंक चैट बॉक्स में
मैम उन लोग को नहीं दिखेगा लेकिन जो जिन लोग को जोड़ना चाहिए उन लोग को नहीं दिखेगा
इन लोगों को दिख जाएगा
ना हाँ सर मैम सेंड करा देंगे
ओके 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 तो दिस चैट दिस लिंक विल अलाउ 100 पीपल टू जॉइन सिंस देयर आर मोर देन 100 पीपल वी आर सेंडिंग अनदर लिंक दिस लिंक विल बी सेंड बाय द रेजिडेंट्स अमंग्स यू ऑल सो प्लीज स्टार्ट
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन टुडे वी आर हियर टू डिलीवर अ प्रेजेंटेशन ऑन द टॉपिक How to write a thesis synopsis under the guidance of Dr. Shelly Awasthi ma'am. At the end of our presentation, a postgraduate student would be able to know steps of writing a thesis synopsis. Our presentation is divided into three parts. The first part will cover the topics on how to formulate a research question, the PICO-TT statement, review of literature, hypothesis, difference between aims and objective, drafting the material and methods, title, and how to write references. The second part will cover how to set a SMART objective, how to choose an appropriate study design, importance of an adequate sample size. The third would cover study variables, data collection tool, and formulation of informed consent form. First of all, any research has a life cycle. It begins with an uncertainty or a need in a particular area, that need is translated into research question, subsequently as a study objective, and a plan of analysis is formulated to guide framing data collection instrument. Using these tools, data is collected, subsequently is analyzed as per plan, and as per the objective, conclusions were drawn, and then recommendations were formulated. And this particular recommendation is shared with the stakeholders for whom it matters. This process ends with another uncertainty and begins the cycle once again. Now, what is a synopsis? The research synopsis is the plan for your thesis. It includes justification of the study. It provides the rationale for the research objectives, the proposed methods for data collection, and it gives a panoramic view of your research for quick analysis by the reviewers. 1 minute, please.
We are opening the second link. Tell
दोनों लिंक पे जा रहा होगा ना प्रेजेंटेशन
करना पड़ेगा ना अंग्रेजी कर दे रहे हैं पर चलो भगवान अलग अलग तरीके से जाता है
स्थिति हाँ मिल रही दूसरी लिंक खोल दी हाउसफुल हो गए दूसरी लिंक हमें भेजोगे
Now, what is a synopsis? The research synopsis is the plan for your thesis. It includes justification of the study. It provides the rationale for the research objectives, the proposed methods for data collection. It gives a panoramic view of your research for quick analysis by the reviewers. Now, how to formulate a research question? Research question is an uncertainty about something in the population that the investigator wants to resolve. By making measurements in the study population, uncertainty in the research life cycle referred as a data need, and a clear research question should facilitate to choose the most optimal design, identify who should be included, what the outcomes should be, and when the outcomes need to be measured. Now, how to translate uncertainty to research question? Frame problem in specific terms. And the research question should preferably focus on one issue, should be written in everyday language, can use more than one operational verb if needed, should link the question to the potential action that would be taken once the question is answered, and it should be stated as a question. Now, what are the 6 steps in conceiving a research question? Suppose, let's take an example. Should diabetics should do exercise daily? Then first of all, one reviews the literature, that is review of state of art information. And literature shows exercise reduces blood sugar, body fat, and improves protection against developing diabetes related complications. So according to literature, definitely this is worth investigating. Then after that, one should raise a question. Can exercise help control blood sugar level? This question sounds better than the earlier, but is rather vague. It needs to be defined more properly. Then decide worth investigating it by peer review. Then define measurable exposures, that is the exercise and outcomes, that was the glucose level. For example, what are the optimal type, frequency, intensity, and duration of exercise. An outcome, either it should be the fasting blood sugar level or postprandial or the random one. Then sharpen the initial question. For example, among diabetics, does physical activity for 1 hour daily help in reducing fasting blood sugar level? Then at last, refine the questions by specifying some more details. For example, what is their study population, the operational definition of variables, and their study design. Now coming to the PICO-TT statement. A clinical question needs to be directly relevant to the patient or problem at hand and phrased in such a way as to facilitate the search for an answer. So PICO-TT acronym makes this process easier, is a mnemonic for the important parts of a well-built clinical research question. P stands for patient and problem. That is, starting with your patient, ask, how would I describe a group of patients similar to mine? I stand for the intervention. Is the intervention a medication, procedure, diagnostic test, questionnaire, or time? Be specific. C stands for comparison. C stands for comparison. What is the main alternative to compare with the intervention? A placebo or current standard of care? Again, be specific. O stands for outcome, which should include patient-oriented outcomes, for example, morbidity, mortality, quality of life, etc. T stands for type of question. Identify the question scenario, therapy, diagnosis, prognosis, harm, etiology, etc. And the next T stands for type of study. That is, what is the ideal study design to answer this question? What type of individual studies do you realistically hope to find? So, the research question when applied to a PICO-TT statement should look like, in pregnant women, would nuchal translucency ultrasound plus serum biochemistry during the first trimester, when compared with conventional amniocentesis, led to accurate diagnosis measured by sensitivity and specificity of Down syndrome? And the type of question here is a diagnostic one. And this study is a prospective blind comparison to gold standard. One more acronym is FINER. A good research question should pass this so what test. That is, it should be feasible. That is, adequate number of participants, technical expertise and resource should be there. Should be interesting enough and novel. That is, it confirms or refutes or extends previous findings and should provide new information and should be ethical enough to be amenable by the ethics committee and should be relevant. That is, advanced scientific knowledge and should improve practice and should influence the policy. Then reasons for carrying out research, that is the introduction. It should be written in 150 to 175 words and should include the background information of your concerned topic. What works, if any, already exist in your area and what are its strengths and deficiencies? What would further your work advance or knowledge of the wider area of study? Is an entirely new area of study being opened up and why is this important? Now coming to the review of literature, it tells about the existing knowledge and research in your concerned area. It addresses the unaddressed issues or gaps, helps to evaluate the literature relating to the content of the work, and to focus on the theoretical and practical aspects already researched and areas of research left unexplored. So literature review is not just a summary. First of all, we need to retrieve the information, for which one should scan the literature efficiently using manual or computerized methods to identify a set of potentially useful articles and books. And after that, one must critically appraise the information, that is, what is useful for your area of research and what is not. You should segregate that. So literature review is an organized search which follows the following step ladders. The first includes the organization of information. Then one should synthesize the results, identify the lacunae, and develop questions for further research. Now, where to search for your research questions and what is the better places for it? If one needs to extract the general information, then everyone knows that Google is a large web search engines, and Health on Net certified sites also comes. But when one has to search for some specific queries, like all trials for the gold standard diagnostic test in tuberculosis, then one needs to be more specific regarding the database engines, and they are PubMed, Scopus, Google Scholar databases, etc. And when one needs to open a full text archived articles, then one should go to the free open access or a fee-based libraries. It may be an online e-library or the physical libraries of our universities. When one needs to search for systematic reviews, meta-analysis, or evidence-based medicines, then Cochrane Library is the most popular one, and Map of Medicine is also one. Now coming to the popular PubMed. PubMed comprises of more than 25 million citations of biomedical literature, is maintained by National Center for Biotechnological Information, situated in National Library for Medicine under National Institute of Health. This PubMed is free and open to access and has collection of abstracts and full text articles, and each abstract has a link via which one can go to the full text article. And there are certain articles where you can freely access through a portal called PMC, that is PubMed Center. And there is a good tutorial on the landing page of PubMed also, where one can learn how to do search on PubMed, how to search via Boolean queries, how to search via citations, name of authors, or date of publications. Apart from that, the US National Library is maintaining their own set of predefined vocabulary called MeSH, that is Medical Subject Headings. It is the NLM-controlled vocabulary thesaurus used for indexing articles for PubMed. So in literature review, first of all, one need to read and criticize the studies, then select those of good qualities, compare the methods, results, findings, etc., then tabulate information from each study and compare. So this is the example of table of literature, where there are several rows and columns. The rows includes the citation, design, objectives, study population, sample size, measurable outcome and results, and at last, the author's conclusion. And in the columns, one should place their studies in chronological orders, that is from recent to past. So when one writes a literature review, it should contain three parts. The first one, that is the introduction, should include the purpose of review, organization of review, basis for ordering, most important to least, and earliest to most recent. The second one, that is the empirical literature, should include quality studies relevant to topic, explain each study using paraphrasing rather than direct quotes, is clearly but brief critic of studies, its strength and weaknesses, and at last the summary, should concise presentation of the research knowledge about a selected topic, what is known and what is not. Now, what is an hypothesis? A hypothesis is a guiding thought. It's an idea, a tentative explanation to a problem to be established or proved or modified or changed or even to be rejected in the lights of finding. A good hypothesis should be simple, specific, and stated in advance. That is, should include one exposure and one outcome. There must not be any ambiguity about study participants and variables, and must be written in advance and should focus on primary objective. A good hypothesis should be written in a declarative sentence, must be written in the present tense, contain the population and the variables, reflect the problem statement, purpose statement, and research question, and should be empirically testable. Types of hypothesis. The first one is the simple hypothesis. A simple hypothesis is that one in which there exists relationship between two variables. One is called independent variable or cause, and the other the dependent variable or effect. For example, smoking leads to cancer. Second one is a complex, in which relationship among variables exist. For example, smoking and other drugs leads to cancer, tension, chest infection, etc. Null hypothesis predicts no relationship between variables and should be statistically analyzed. A research hypothesis states expected relationships between variables and can be directional or non-directional. Aims and objectives. Aim means what you hope to achieve, whereas objective are the actions you will take in order to achieve the aim. Aims are statements of intent. Objectives should be specific statements that define measurable outcomes. Example, what steps will be taken to achieve the desired goal. For example, an aim of a study is to identify the bacterial and fungal etiological agents associated with ventilator-associated pneumonia. Its objectives are to monitor adult patients on mechanical ventilator in medical intensive care unit for the development of VAP by clinical and radiological criteria. And the second is to process endotracheal aspirates and bronchoalveolar lavage samples quantitatively for the identification of causative organism. Now coming to the material and methods. First of all, it should include the study settings, that is the physical, social site in which the researcher conducts the study. The study design, which will be discussed in the subsequent slides. Then the study duration, then what are the inclusion and exclusion criteria, materials required, sample size estimation, assessment tool, ethical clearance, data analysis, and implication of work. That is the specific suggestions that you make with regard to further research on the topic. And the implications are basically the conclusions that you draw from your results and explain how the findings may be important for practice and theory. Now, after completing all this, one needs to refine the title. So what is the characteristics of an effective title? It should indicate accurately the subject and scope of the study, should avoid using abbreviations, use words that create a positive impression and stimulate reader interest, should identify key variables, both dependent and independent, is limited to 10 to 15 substantive words, and titles are usually in the form of a phrase, but can also be in the form of a question. So example of a good title is clinical profile, comorbidities, and health-related quality of life in pediatrics patient with allergic rhinitis and asthma. An example of a bad title is neurological manifestations of HIV infection, where HIV is used as an abbreviation, and about the study settings, designs, and about the variables is not mentioned properly over here. Now, how to write references. Consideration of where you will find information to support your arguments should go hand in hand, and where sources are used, they should be listed at the end of synopsis, and you should be prepared to discuss them when asked. References are preferably written in two styles. The first one is the Vancouver style. First of all, while writing references in Vancouver style, we should write author of chapter, then title of chapter, then subtitle of chapter, then the editor's name, then title of book, then the publisher, then the place, publisher, and the year. The second one is the Harvard style, where we write first of all the author, then comes the year, then the article title, then the journal title, and the volume and issue of the journal, the page number, the library database, and the access date also. That's all from my side. Now the seminar will be further taken by my colleague, Dr. Garvita.
A very good afternoon to all. So the topics that I will be covering are how to set a SMART objective, how to choose an appropriate study design, and what is the importance of an adequate sample size. Now let's start with how to set a SMART objective. We must know that what are the characteristics of a SMART objective. An objective should be specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and time scale. I would be elaborating these points on my slides in my slides ahead. Now the points that are to be observed while developing research objective are: we must make it brief and concise. We must put them in logical sequence. Our objectives should be realistic and should be phrased in operational terms. And we must use action verbs that are specific enough to be evaluated. Now, how do we make each objective specific? We must ask ourselves certain set of questions before framing an objective. What exactly are we going to do? With what and for whom? Is it clear who is involved? And is the intended outcome clear? This means that the population of interest in which we are going to do a particular intervention or an observation should be clear-cut defined along with its intended outcome. Is each objective measurable? How will we know that the intended change has occurred? Can these measurements be obtained? When will it be measured? Now here we are talking about that the intended outcome or the outcome of interest should be objectively defined, and also the time duration after which we will measure those outcomes should be defined. Is each objective achievable? That is, can we get it done in the proposed time frame? Can we do this with the resources that we have? Is this even possible? Here we are talking about the feasibility of our objective, that we must be able to do it with the available resources and in the proposed time frame. Again, we must make our objective timescaled. Now, I would like to explain my points with the help of certain examples. Now, we will see that how can we convert a bad objective into a SMART one. Here is an example that says that to evaluate the relationship between diabetes and depression. Now we can see that we do not know that how are we going to evaluate that relationship. It is non-specific and the outcome cannot be measured in objective form. We can convert it into a good objective by saying that determine whether depression is more common among diabetics as compared to healthy individuals in those who self-report to psychiatry OPD and are diagnosed as having depression as determined by the patient health questionnaire 9 depression score over a period of 1 year by assessing the levels of random blood sugar and HbA1c levels in them. Now, as we can see that this objective is specific as we have a specific score. It's measurable because the outcome can be measured in the form of the ones who are having diabetes by measuring the levels of the random blood sugar and HbA1c. It's achievable and time bound because we are doing it, we have specified that we are doing it over a period of 1 year. Here is yet another example that says to investigate the effect of local insulin injection therapy in patient of diabetic. Now we do not know that what are the effects that we are to look forward to in that diabetic foot ulcer? Is it in terms of the time of healing? Is it in terms of new tissue formation? So this makes this statement non-specific. Now we can reframe it as to investigate the effect of local insulin injection therapy on granulation tissue formation and revascularization of the wound in diabetic foot ulcer admitted in the surgery ward for a period of 1 year. Now this statement is more specific, it's measurable because we're measuring it in the form of new granulation tissue formation and revascularization, and again the time period is specified, so it is time bound. So the next topic is how to choose an appropriate study design. For this, we must be aware that there are various study designs. So our epidemiological studies could be either descriptive or analytical. In descriptive, if the unit of study is an individual, then it could either be a case report, case series, or equal or a cross-section. Now, a case report is a detailed presentation of a single case. A case series is the study of a larger group of patients with a particular disease. It's a very common way of delineating the clinical picture of a disease. And cross-sectional surveys are basically surveys that are done in a cross-section of society at one point of time. Now, if our unit of analysis is a population or a group, then it's an ecological study. It is used in various surveys for studying the trends of disease. Now, the next form of study is analytical. In analytical study, it could either be observational or interventional. In observational, we have case control and cohort. I would further elaborate these points in my slides ahead. Now, how do we decide that what type of study design we have to assign for our synopsis? So we must first ask ourselves certain question that are we going to assign any new exposure in our study? If the answer to that question is yes, then it's an experimental study. If we are randomly allocating that new exposure, then it's a randomized control trial. If you're not randomly allocating the exposure, it's a non-randomized control trial. If we are not allocating any new exposure, then it's an observational study. Then in order to know what kind of observational study, we must ask ourselves that is there going to be any comparison group? If no, then it's a descriptive study. That could either be a case report, a case series, or ecological study. If there are indeed going to be comparison groups, then it's an analytical study. In order to know what kind of analytical study, we must understand the relationship between the exposure and the outcome. If the exposure has occurred and we are going forward in time to look for the occurrence of outcome, then it's a cohort study or rather a conventional cohort study. If the outcome has occurred and we are going back in time to compare the different kind of exposures, then it's a case control study. If both exposure and outcome have occurred at the same time, then it's a cross-sectional study. Now, again, I have, now here is a table that further elaborates the study. In cross-sectional study, an intervention is usually absent, and the risk factor and outcome are studied at the same time. In a case control study, an intervention is again absent. The outcome occurs first, and then we retrospectively look for the presence of any exposure or risk factor. In a cohort study, an intervention is again absent. The risk factor or exposure has occurred first, and then we are looking forward for the occurrence of an outcome. In a clinical trial, an intervention is present, and we have to intervene, and then we have to measure the outcome. Now, here are certain examples of these studies. To determine the proportion of children aged 5 to 14 years having a hemoglobin of less than 7 gram per deciliter in those attending OPD of KGMU for a period of 1 year, Here, we are studying the proportion, that is, we are studying a cross-section of population at one point of time to determine the proportion of a disease. Now, this makes it a cross-sectional study. Now, here is a classical example of a cohort study that says that to study the factors associated with the development of cardiovascular disease in an adult population aged 30 to 59 years in Framingham for a period of 20 years. Here we are going with the risk factor to the development of a disease, hence it is a cohort study. Now the next example is that of a case control study. To determine the association of exclusive breastfeeding and the development of Crohn's disease in children suffering from Crohn's disease in a tertiary care health center. Now, here's a 2x2 table that defines that our exposure is the presence of exclusive breastfeeding and our outcome is Crohn's disease, which now it could either be we have cases and we have control. In the control group, the disease will be absent, and in the cases group, the disease will be present. And we are going back in time and to look forward to look for the presence of exposure. That is our exclusive breastfeeding. The next is randomized control trial. To assess whether IV dexamethasone given for 2 days decreases the time of recovery in patients with paraneumonic pleural effusion in children aged 1 month to 14 years in comparison to the ones who receive placebo. Here we are doing an intervention and we are dividing it in two groups, one receiving that intervention and one receiving placebo, and we are looking for the occurrence of an outcome. That makes it a randomized controlled trial. Now the next topic is the importance of an adequate sample size. Why do we sample populations? In order to obtain information from large groups, to ensure the efficiency of a study, and to obtain more accurate information. Here's an image that says that we have a whole population. Our target population is determined by our sampling criteria. Our accessible population is that population which is available to the researcher, and the sample size is that portion which is selected with the sampling plan or method, and the ones which we recruit are our study elements, subjects or participants. How large or how small a sample size do we need? If the sample size is too small, even a well-conducted study may fail to answer its research question. It may fail to detect important effects or association. If the sample size is too large, we have issues with the time constant. There is loss of accuracy, and it can become too difficult and costly for us to be able to do our study. Yet another point that we need to keep in our mind is that if a similar study has been done in the past, it is important that one notes down the important risk factors and their significance level while calculating the sample size. Now, there are various softwares that are available for calculating sample size. We have ClinCalc sample size calculator, we have BrowSoft sample size calculator, we have PAR and sample size calculator. Now, the seminar will be further conducted by my matchmate Dr. Devina Singh.
आप एक मिनट ये आपने दवा तो समझ ली 10 फरवरी को आइएगा एक मिनट वहाँ बैठिए अभी बात करते हैं आपसे
गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल नाउ आई विल बी डिस्कसिंग द स्टडी वेरिएबल्स एंड फॉर्मुलेशन ऑफ डेटा कलेक्शन टूल एंड इन्फॉर्म्ड कंसेंट फॉर्म since these are required to be submitted along with the synopsis. Coming to the study variables, a variable is a feature of a member of a given sample or population which is unique and can differ in quantity from another member of the same sample or population. So here I have taken example of a case record form of district childhood pneumonia surveillance, where we can see different variables. For example, age in months, gender, which can be either male or female, place of residence, family type, mother's age, education, father's education, and so on and so forth. Now, variables can be classified into following types. It can be either a nominal variable, which is based on names, and there is no specific order to be followed. For example, gender, which can be either male or female, or a residence, which can be rural or urban. Variable can also be of ordinal type, where we depict order of variables. And once, for example, TNM staging and Kuppuswamy scale, here one stage follows other, and any stage cannot be allocated randomly. Then variables are also of interval type, where there is an absence of absolute zero. Therefore, no ratios are possible. For example, centigrade and Fahrenheit temperature scale. It can also be of ratio type, where there is presence of absolute zero. Therefore, ratios are possible. For example, weight, height, blood glucose levels. Now, variables can also be classified into an independent or dependent type. Independent variables are also known as exposure variables or risk factor or X variable, whereas dependent variables are also known as outcome variables or response variable or a Y variable. The independent variables are those that are changed or controlled in scientific experiment to test the effects on dependent variables, whereas the dependent variables are affected by and respond to independent variables. The values of independent variables can be changed or manipulated as per requirements of the investigator and in order to affect the dependent variable, whereas the values of dependent variables cannot be manipulated. An independent variable is a presumed cause, whereas the dependent variable is a measured effect. I will be describing it with the help of an example, that is, effect of severe vitamin D deficiency at admission on shock reversal in children with septic shock. Here, vitamin D deficiency is the independent variable, whereas the shock reversal is dependent variable. Coming to another set of variable, that is the confounders. Confounders should be identified beforehand in the study. And these are those factors which are other than the exposure or intervention that may affect the outcome of interest and that can be related to exposure or intervention. Therefore, they can lead to spurious association. Here, I will be taking example of a hypothesis that alcohol use leads to lung cancer. But here, smoking is also associated with alcohol use. The people who are alcoholics have more cigarettes as compared to non-alcoholics, as well as smoking is independently associated with lung cancer. Therefore, it can lead to a spurious association between alcohol use and lung cancer. Coming on to selection of right independent variable, it is important and it is done on the basis of thorough review of literature. The independent variables, dependent variables, as well as the confounders should be identified beforehand. Then the variables should be defined and it should be categorized into categorical or continuous variables. Further definition of variables I will be discussing in data collection form. Now coming to the development of study instrument. Development of good study instrument is important. And the information which is collected with the data collection tools should be relevant to the research performed. Generally, we follow the following order of questions. First of all, we take the individual characteristics of the participants, for example, age or gender. Then we move on to the demographic profile, for example, place of residence. Then we come on to the history of the participant. In the history, it is important to take the relevant history. For example, if the research population includes neonates, then antenatal and perinatal history gains importance. Whereas if the study population consists of adolescents, then this antenatal or perinatal history will not hold much importance. then we take information about general examination, systemic examination, investigations which are relevant to the study, treatment given to the participant, outcome of the participant, and follow up if required in the study. Then moving on to the defining a variable in a data collection form. First of all, we have to name a variable. Then we have to assign an abbreviation. We have to set its width, that is number of digits which are displayed for numeric values, or length of string variables. Then the number of digits that will be displayed before or after and after the decimals. We have to define the values of the variable. We have to do coding of the values for categorical data, which should be preferably numeric coding. We have to decide on missing values, and we have to write its unit. I will be sharing an example of metric data. For example, height. We will be abbreviating height as HT. The variable type is numeric. The missing value which we are taking here is 999.9, and unit is centimeter. So in our data collection tool, we will be writing as height, followed by a bracket, followed by HT as abbreviation, followed by three boxes before decimal and one box after the decimal, followed by the unit, that is centimeters. Here, it is important to note that all the boxes are to be filled. For example, if height of a participant is 90.5 centimeter, then it should be filled as 090.5 centimeters. Then example of categorical data. Here I have taken example of Kuppuswamy scale. It can be abbreviated as K scale. Its coding needs to be done since it is a string variable. For upper class, we code it as 1, upper middle as 2, lower middle as 3, upper lower as 4, and lower as 5. Missing value is designed as 9. So in our data collection tool, we will be writing as Kuppuswamy scale, followed by bracket, followed by K scale, that is its abbreviation, followed by a box for noting the value. So by the previous slides, it has been clear that while creating the variable names, the variable's name should be clear and crisp. It should be understandable. It should be short and should not be having any space, since most of the softwares require less than 10 characters. It should be consistent and there should be no duplicate. It is important to assign the variable name beforehand, because later on during data management, if the software is left to assign the variable name, then it can create duplicate, which would pose a hindrance in data analysis. Coming on to coding, as already discussed, numerical coding should be preferred, and we should be deciding earlier only on missing values, which is most of the time missed by the beginners. Missing values should be assigned as a point or 999 or 999 or in the multiples of 9, and the different digits are not applicable. For example, we cannot code missing values as 8, 98 or 998. We should avoid cumbersome codes. For example, if blood group is a part of our data, then blood group A is coded as 1 and blood group B is coded as 2. Then someone may fancy coding blood group AB as 1, 2, which is wrong, and one should preferably code blood group AB as 3. Then for gradients like yes or no or present or absent, we should use as 1 or 0 as a coding, or 1 or 2 as coding. Then pilot testing of the data collection tool is important before going into field. We should be checking that the instrument is clear and crisp. It is understandable. It should be preferably in local language, that is Hindi in our case. It should be acceptable. That is, people should not be wary of answering the questions. One should check the flow and skip pattern. One should check the pertinence of coding and estimate the time needed to answer all the needed to ask all the questions, that whether it is actually that whether a person is actually able to finish it in time or not. Pilot testing is done with few volunteers. These are the volunteers are those people who are similar to the study population. And it should be noted here that those people who are included in pilot testing should not be made a part of study later on. Then here I have shared an example of a good case record form of district childhood pneumonia surveillance, which is being conducted under Professor Dr. Shelly Awasthi ma'am. Here we can see that first of all, they have taken the profile of the patient, that is age in months, followed by two boxes for the same date of birth, gender. Then they have taken the socioeconomic status of the patient. Then after that, they have come on to the anthropometry, that is length or height, mid upper arm circumference, weight in kilograms, head circumference. Then since it is a childhood pneumonia surveillance program, therefore immunization status is important. So here they have taken the immunization status history in detail. Then after that, they have taken the family history and history of presenting symptoms. Here, it is important to note that they have mentioned the source of their examination findings, like they have abstracted the examination findings from the case sheet. Then further, they have mentioned all the investigations which are required, the diagnosis by the physician, and final outcome of the patient. Now moving on to how to write an informed consent form. It is important for us as researchers to protect the welfare and safety of research participants. Ethical foundation is implicit not only for medical but for all type of researches. Following ethical principles are to be followed. The Belmont report that was reported in 1978 to 1979 described following basic ethical principles. Respect for autonomy. One must not interfere with the decision of competent adults or the patient's attendants in the case of children. Justice. We have obligation to treat all patients equally, fairly, and impartially, whether they decide to participate in our research or not, or decide against it. Beneficence, fair and correct in all actions, and one must take positive steps to prevent any harm. And non-maleficence, that is, we must not harm others, and whatever harm could not be avoided should be reduced. So, what is an informed consent? An informed consent is the process of informing the potential participants about the proposed research in a systematic manner and empower them to take an informed decision to participate in the research study. The participant should understand the study procedures and risks and benefits. They should get all questions and concerns answered, and they should be able to take a learned and informed decision whether to participate or not to participate. This process can be repeated several times during the research study if necessary. Here, it is important to note that although group consent is desirable, for example, in tribal studies, since it involves a sensitive group of population, but it cannot replace individual consent. If the individual is consenting against being a participant of the study, then his or her decision should be respected. So, here I will be discussing the parts of an informed consent document. It includes research description. The research procedure should be described in brief. The potential risk should be told to the participants. The benefits should be told. It is possible that benefits are not individual oriented, and sometimes they benefit the whole community, and this should be communicated correctly and clearly. The alternatives should be told to the participants. They have to be explained that it is fine if they don't want to participate in research. They will continue to get the benefit even if they risk. Since sometimes sensitive information is shared, they should be told about compensation beforehand in case any untoward event happens during research. The contact of investigator and member secretary of ethical review committee should be shared with the participants. They should be also told about voluntary participation and withdrawal. That is, they have a right to take learned and informed decision to participate or not to participate. Participant may decide to drop off the study after a certain period of time, and it is within the right of the participants to do so. Then we get the signature of the participant and a witness which is not a part of the study team. The signature of witness becomes more important in case if the participant is illiterate. Then here I have shared a link for WHO templates for informed consent and assent forms. Assent is taken from a child of between 8 to 16 years of age, and it is important and it is an important part, since the children are below 18 years, so they cannot give the consent. The consent is given by the parents, whereas the assent is given by the child, that whether he wants to be a part of the study or does not want to be a part. Here I have shared an example of an informed consent form in Hindi. It includes the objectives of the study, the methodology, the risk of the study, benefits, the compensation, confidentiality, and the alternatives, and voluntary participation and withdrawal. The part two includes parents' or guardians' consent, since this program is involving children, or the participants' consent in case the participant is an adult. And here is the investigator's statement. So our take-home message is that synopsis is the beginning of a good research. It is an absolute requirement for official purposes. It must be short, succinct, but it should be informative. These are our references. Thank you to all for your patient listening.
So with this, we have come to part one of our presentation, that is telling you how to write the synopsis. There will be questions. I will take the questions, but before that, now Dr. Nisha Pandey will tell you how you will integrate research into your residency. Dr. Pandey, in color, thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Now we I have to talk about how to integrate research with residency. First of all, I would like to tell you that Anshika, Garvita, and Devinath, all three given a very short but very nice lecture on how to develop a synopsis. And after this session, I think you all must have a long breath, get relaxed, and then I will start about how to integrate research with residency. So I would like to tell you all that please take a good breath. Take up to your belly, tummy, belly button, and then relax. Again, take a long breath. Relax. So, I hope you all might have a relaxing feeling. Outline of my talk is, what is the need of research? Then basic requirements for doing research, then how to integrate residency with research. I would like to talk on work-life balance. Then develop interest, understand various concepts and clear doubts, mandatory training, research planning and process, supportive environment, and contribute to scientific endeavor and update the skill. The need of research is there in every day of our life. Research is needed for everyone, for each and every aspect of life. We all research in this COVID time. We researched for making good food, how to prepare it when maid was not coming. You was not knowing that how to cook food, how to get food. Then you all must have had some YouTube research, or you must have seen some recipe and all, and you made your food at home. So what was that? That was your need. It is all need based. So for research, we should know that we have to develop an interest in ourselves. So the need, when we understand the need, we go for it. We definitely go for it and we explore things. In day-to-day life, we do it. And for residency, it is all of your choice. And you must be knowing that during residency, we have to do a lot of work. Whenever I meet to any of the residents our first year, they always say, I'm very busy. There is no time for sleep. So how to manage all these things? Because we are knowing that what is going with us, what we have to do. And before residency, we start preparation for going to PG classes from third year, I think. Most of you are starting preparation from MBBS level. And when we know that what is the requirement of all these things, then we have to get a relaxed environment within us. And from core of heart, we have to think that whatever we are going to opt, that needs this much of thing from us. So that's why we have to think on it and we have to get ready. So the need of research for day-to-day practice, basically for medical practitioners, they need to develop rational way of thinking for expert and exhaustive treatments, solutions with scientific approach, with exactness and do analysis, relationship of facts, careful recording, and honesty and hard work. That all is needed for a medical practitioner, and you all are knowing that and you opted that, and you have to be very curious and you have to be cope up with all these things. I have given the task that there is a problem when we have to research with all these kinds of things. So how we can go about it? So research includes rewarding and satisfying growth. As I am a researcher, I feel that it is very rewarding and gives satisfying growth. It gives opportunities for lifelong progress and opens door for innovation, provides global career and opportunities. If you want to be a faculty, you have to have some publications, good research background, and for that, you have to have research. So if you will start thinking on it, if you will develop the interest for research, you will definitely get the time. And I will tell that how you can integrate it with your exhaustive residency. So basic requirements for doing research is to be curious, to be creative, to be determined and disciplined, focus, openness, patience, and positive attitude. And that is a must for everyone. That is must in this corona kal. We all are facing a lot of problem, but people who are with positive attitude, they are getting better. If they have some COVID infection, they do better, they get better, and this is all basic requirement for doing a research. So how to integrate research with residency? For that, we have first to balance our work life. Work life balance is a must. For that, what we have to do? First of all, we have to plan what we are doing. We have to prioritize and set goals. So planning what? How to go about it? A good plan to be developed and prioritize that what to do first and what to be done afterwards, and set goals, some long-term goals and some short-term goals. So first, self-care, and that self-care includes your inner strength. You need to develop your inner strength. That gives you a lot of willpower to do each and every thing in a positive manner. Then a good interpersonal relationship. Interpersonal relationship, whoever is important for you, try to connect with them. If not physically, you can connect on phone. I know some people who are far away from their family since last 12 months, since this corona, but they are talking to their family on daily basis and they get the strength. That is a good thing. So interpersonal relationship is a must. From your time, you have to keep some time for interpersonal relationship, and your social relationship should be maintained. Then time management, which is very important for you people. That is a must thing, that how we should manage the time. So set goals for your future. Short-term goals, some short-term goals, some long-term goals. And there should be an attitude that whatever the goal is set, you have to do the work on that goal to achieve your thing, your whatever you thought to achieve. And then don't waste time. Try to maintain it, and you will see there will be a lot of difference in your day-to-day life. Then develop interest, understand concept, and clear doubts. It is a must that when we develop interest in anything, like I talked about the cooking, which is not now nowadays people are not liking. Every time we try to phone or we try to get it from other places, and from where it, if it is a small occasion, we try to get food from hotel or restaurant, we try to go there. But what happened when we cannot go outside? So what we did, we have to develop that interest and understand the concepts and clear doubts. When there is no doubt, when we understand the concepts, like Garvita, Anshika and Devina, all three told about that, how to develop a good synopsis. how to review the literature, how to set the SMART objectives, then how to define the variables. If you will understand each and every concept, you will clear the doubts. Definitely you will develop the interest. So brainstorming through case presentation, seminar, general term, they are there. These are there. And you have to do it by brainstorming with your colleagues and in seminars, in general clubs, you can develop such kind of things and you can discuss with your peer group and as well as with your guide, teacher, and you can have the understanding of concepts, and when you clear your doubts, you will definitely try to integrate both research and the clinical work together. Develop an understanding for interpretation of the available literature and then recognize new questions that need investigation. So for research, we have to do this, and then we will definitely can go for it. Then mandatory training helps in research, and MAM started this program because of this only, that the seminar will be is started, and we are thinking that there will be mandatory training, and you all might be knowing that ICMR is running a program for 23 lectures on research methodology. If you want to do that, this is the site. So you can get from this and you can attend this lecture also. So the basic of these all three is 23 lecture is conceptualization of a research study, epidemiological and biostatistical considerations in designing a research, planning and conducting a research study, writing a research protocol and publication ethics. Materials used in this program is video lectures, presentation slides, supplements, including different concepts and steps involved in a health research using a single example throughout the course, reading materials and assignments. So research planning and process. Understand research planning and process. That will also help you to integrate it with your residency. So in planning, कुछ प्रेजेंटेशन बंद हो गया, शुरू कर दो। So we had to plan, think about planning and process of research, what time and resources should be there, research processes, develop new skills and make presentations, then formulating a research problem, identifying variables, which all were told earlier. So I am not taking time on this. Then supportive environment, proper observance and guidance. Some of the things which is to be taken care by the administration, and some of the things which is taken to be care by you yourself, and that will probably help in integrating research with residency. So proper observance and guidance, healthy communication, uniform guidelines,
then critical analysis at every step, compassionate atmosphere, inspirational supervision and guidance, and financial support. At times we need to conduct the research, financial support, and in residency period the time is less and the financial supports come afterwards that hinders our work. So we have to be prepared. The resident should be prepared for critical analysis at every step, and at every step we should welcome all critical analysis. An environment of healthy communication should be both way, from us and from you, and uniform guidelines. Some of the, I asked some of the residents that what should be there to integrate research with residency, and some of them said me that there is no uniform guidelines, ma'am, and that's why sometimes we don't know how many of the subjects to be included. Some of the theses are there where less subjects are included and that is passed, and sometimes there are hurdles. So there should be uniform guidelines which needs to be improvised, definitely, yes. That is being done, critical analysis at every step. If your guide, your supervisor, your mentor says that it should be done like this, and what is this, hear that carefully and take the message which is positive for you. That will enhance your capabilities. There is no one here who is telling you anything for any bad thing. It is all for your in your goodwill. So contribute to scientific endeavor and update skills. For that you have to attend workshops, seminar, be curious, write manuscripts, case reports, articles, papers, contribute to seminars, conferences and scientific journals. Then I am giving a small assignment to you all, as you all today learned about how to prepare a synopsis. So I am giving an assignment: get a recently published full text article of your interest, whatever it is. It may be from literature, it may be from anywhere. Get a recently published full text article of your interest. Plan and develop a research question and make a summary of synopsis. The brief write-up of synopsis to be submitted to res@kgmcindia.edu or nishamani@kgmcindia.edu. Please do it and develop your interest. You will, if you will work on it, you will definitely get the way to integrate research with residency. Thank you.
Thank you. So, thank you very much, Dr. Nisha. Now I am here. I am sitting here. Usko bula to PowerPoint off kar de. We have finished our presentations. If there is any question you want to ask on the presentations given by the girls, I am willing to take it up. You can write it on the chat box or you can raise your hands and ask me. Any questions, all questions are welcome. We will have a 5 minutes question and answer session if you wish. We can have longer if you want. First of all, did you like the presentation? Yes. Sudipti, thank you, ma'am, for your enlightening words. Okay, thank you. It's very encouraging to get a positive feedback. Now, all of you have got a link on the chat box. Please fill the Google form. Those of you who fill the form, we will give you an e-certificate of participation. Anything, any concept which was not cleared, do let me know. As of now, I'm willing to answer your question if there's a burning question. It was simple and informative. Okay. Any other comment, any question, anything which wasn't clear to you all? So if you're not asking questions, we plan to make it almost every month. And every month we will build on your capacities in a step ladder fashion, so that by the end of 1 year, you all have a quantum increase in your knowledge. So if there's nothing, I will stop the presentation. Thank you all very much for being here today. What? Is there a question?
There is no link in second group. Which one is? Which one is second?
There are link. There are questions.
No.
Okay, the second link, we will send you the e-question. Dr. Pearl will send you. Okay. Somebody from outside wants to join. Okay. So we will send you the e-question just now in the second link, and thank you all very much. E-question. Now let me announce the next class. The next class will be we will have a question and we will have a study design, and we will tell you what is the advantage and disadvantage of study designs. If we want to make it interactive, we will try to do that. That would be in the month of February. बैठ जाओ।
सॉरी, ऑडियो ऑफ कर दो।